Attention BetMGM customers. You and a friend can both score a $50 bonus through BetMGM's Refer a Friend program. Sign into your BetMGM account to learn more. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. Must be 21 years of age or older to wager. Pennsylvania only. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable site credit. Site credit expires in 30 days. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem, help is available. Call 1-800-GAMBLER. BetMGM Sports in partnership with Hollywood Casino Morgantown.
Yo, 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 it's time for the Kevin and Nikki show. Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
I'm
everybody.
Yes.
Got me working, working day and night.
Hi-ya.
Got me working, Ooh. Working day and night.
Hi-ya.
Got me working, Ooh. Working day and night. Yo, what's up, everybody? It's the Kevin and Nikee Show. We on iHeartRadio and a whole lot
yeah.
more. We are back for another exciting week. We got exciting guests. We got a lot of exciting things to talk about.
Yep.
So we back, Nick.
We back.
We back.
Yeah.
Matt Kidd.
You
my friend.
That you did that last week.
That's our Ice Cube rendition. You know what
yeah,
I'm
saying? Yeah, that's all right. Matt
Kidd. Matt Kidd.
My friend.
My friend. Yeah, yeah.
You play too much.
Hey, Dre, I got something to say. I got something to say.
What up, though?
What up, fool? What up, fool? Why do I gotta be a fool?
I don't know.
What up, fool? it's like, no. Yo, we are back for another edition of the Kevin and Nikee Show, man.
Yeah.
We are excited. We want to thank everybody in listening land for tuning in from the top, middle, and bottom of our hearts.
Yeah.
We do what we do for you. That rhyme.
Yeah.
Yeah, that rhyme.
Oh, you in the rhyming spirit today? Okay.
Man, we might have the rapping pass today. Nah, we might have the rapping pass today. Nah, but yeah, man, it's good to be back again, and great to connect with everyone. And we got another great show ahead of us, as we always do every week.
All the time.
Yeah, so.
All the tizzy.
All the time. Yeah. So, yeah, with that said.
It is time for the many adventures of Kevin and Nikki. Thank you for letting me do that this time, because you always do it. I do.
I can pass it off every now and then.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Pass back and forth.
Right, you got to let me ring the bell one time.
Okay, well, you go ahead. Here.
No, next time. We only ring the bell when it calls
for. All right, so when it calls for, you ring.
All right, I ring. Okay.
All right.
Yeah. All right, so, man, we always got a lot going on.
Yeah.
We always got adventures, so.
Yeah.
What kind of adventures you got going on, man?
Okay, so this is an adventure.
Okay.
It was an adventure for me. So
our adventures are our adventures. You know what I'm saying?
So listen, everybody. I've been on this workout thing.
Okay.
I've been on this workout thing, heavy working out. So,
you too?
Yeah. Oh. So listen, I hit up one of my friends who actually are, you know, trainers, personal trainers. And they said, well, Nick, why don't you just walk up and down your steps? I'm like, well, who got time for that? Walking up and down the steps. So I said, okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the store and I'm going to buy a stepper. Bought the stepper and everything, did my research, went online, and I looked up how many calories are you supposed to be burning weekly. Okay. No, actually, it's daily.
Daily. That's right.
Daily. Okay. It's daily. So I did my research, and they said, okay, so you're supposed to be burning at least 500 to 1,000 calories daily.
Okay, so that's two Big Macs.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, okay, cool. I got this.
Okay.
Got the water, got the towel, the sneakers. I'm ready.
Okay.
Kev, I got on this stepper and I swear, I kid you not, I did 600 steps and only burned 100 calories.
Dang, you ain't burned that many. You did 600 steps and only burned 100 calories.
100 calories. I was sweating like a sinner in church.
Oh my goodness. Well, you gotta do 10,000 more steps.
I don't know what is going on. Google lied.
Mm-mm.
It lied to me. I'm like, well, what is going on? 600 steps, kept only 100 calories. Wow. Something is wrong.
Wow, that is.
And I'm breathing heavy, hanging all over the handlebars and everything. And I'm looking at the thing, it's 100 calories, 600 steps.
Wow.
Listen. I got off.
I hear you.
I got off.
Well, look, here's the thing, though. At least you burned some calories, because burning some calories is better than burning no calories at all. And my theory is just eat one or two less Big Macs, which will put 500 plus 500 calories added to your calorie intake.
So my question to you, how many more steps did I have to do to get the other 400?
I'm thinking 10,000.
Oh my God.
I mean, you gotta burn. How many? You said you gotta burn. How many you gotta burn?
Google said you have to burn,
excuse me,
500 calories, 500 to 1,000 calories a day.
And you did 600.
And all I did was 600 steps.
Oh, you did 600 steps. Okay.
And I burned, doing those 600 steps on the stepper, 100 calories.
Okay. Okay.
So something ain't right.
Right. So yeah, you got a lot more steps to do.
Yes, I have 400 more steps. I mean, I have 400 more calories to burn. So that's how many more steps is that?
Right.
It ain't gonna work.
So it'll be 2,400.
Listen.
You got 2,400 more steps.
The devil is a liar.
Right, because you got 600 calories you got to burn.
No.
How many?
500 to 1,000 calories per day.
Oh, 500 to 1,000 calories per day.
Yes.
And you did 600 steps.
Steps. And only burned 100. Yes.
Oh, yeah. You got it.
Something ain't right.
Yeah, you got it.
Google lied to me.
You got it.
I'm writing a letter.
Yeah.
I'm writing a letter. Yeah, dear Google, liar.
That's it.
Best. Liar.
Then put at the end, best.
Nikee.
No, you gotta put God bless at the end. Yeah, you gotta put God bless at the end as you tell somebody
on. Man, I'm like, what in the world is going on? I'm sweat running everywhere. It's hot. I'm drinking all my water because I'm on this water thing too. Six bottles of water a day. I burnt all that out.
Okay.
I had nothing else.
You gotta be doing math today, man. Listen,
I ain't had nothing else.
I hear you though. Because they say if you drink a gallon of water a day, that can help you lose weight. Of course, you don't have to drink it in one setting.
No, I do it every 2-3 hours.
Or just throughout the course of the day. If you drink a gallon throughout the course of the day, you know, it'll help you lose weight.
Yeah. But Google lied to me. I'm writing a letter.
I'm sure.
Google, liar.
God bless
you, Nikee.
Yeah,
that's what I'm going to do. Yeah.
So you wrapped up some projects too, right?
Yeah. So I wrapped up the substitute.
Okay.
Hallelujah. Wrapped that up because you know we want to wrap up these projects and move on to other projects.
Right,
so
right.
I wrapped up the substitute and I was on set for the No Name.
Okay.
Wrapped that up. The director was so impressed. You know how I do. I got to teach him the one take. Drake knocked them scenes out in one take. I'm just saying, we ain't got time to be on set all day.
Mm-hmm. But it's professional.
I mean, it's
professional
to know your... We have to, but it's professional, like you said, to know your lines, be ready, come in, wardrobe ready, hair, makeup, everything, and be ready to rock and roll.
Right.
And, you know, we're always ready to rock and roll.
Right.
So my thing is, get me from this angle, and it's a wrap.
Let's be done with it. Yeah.
And
it's a courtesy to your actors. It's a courtesy to the production.
Yes.
To be makeup ready, wardrobe ready.
Yeah.
Know your lines, be prepared,
mm-hmm.
because you save them time.
Mm-hmm.
You save them money, you save them film.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
And I was saving a whole lot of time, money, and film
right
over the weekend.
That's
and
what's up.
then the most awesome thing happened to me. Remember I told you my very first film that I did
mm-hmm.
was called Colville?
Yeah.
And remember I told you how the director was impressed and I opened that film up with my performance?
Right.
How about she inboxed me over the weekend and was like, hey, I got you for another one.
I hear you.
Yes. And she was like, this role is much bigger. Screen time all through the entire film. I said, you know, that's where I live.
Right.
On that camera. Holler at your girl.
Right,
she
right.
was like, yes. And then, of course, you know, plugged my boy.
I hear you, man.
Yes,
I appreciate it. You know
yes,
what I'm saying?
Indeed. Yes, indeed.
You know what? And it speaks to one of the many things we've been always talking about
mm-hmm.
is relationship-driven business.
Yes.
And, you know, life has a way of coming full circle. When
mm-hmm.
we talked to our main man, Ryan Godfrey,
yes.
he was telling his story about
yep.
how he went on set, did real, real well, and the director inboxed him years later, and now he's back on set.
Yeah.
You know, this tends to happen a lot when you
yeah.
are, you know, trying to be the consummate professional. You say thank you. You're very appreciative.
Yep.
You do your job.
Yep.
You build relationships with people.
Yep.
It goes a long way. And if your performance can make someone feel,
mm-hmm.
whether it's angry, laugh, hate you, whatever, they'll always remember you.
Yeah.
You know
and
what I mean?
Did I'll that remember. Film, Colville, with her in 2015.
See how life comes full circle?
See that?
Right.
And she said, I know you're hot right now, but I need some of that hotness on my set.
That's
I was like,
up.
All right.
And of course, like the more you tend to grow and your name gets out there,
mm-hmm.
you know, you do have those select group of directors say, hey, I want you to bring that, you know,
yes.
over to this project.
I was like, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Who's that?
Who's
Cardi
that?
B.
Cardi B.
You don't even know.
No, I know who Cardi B is. Yeah.
That's her thing, she says.
Okay.
So what did you do?
Oh, man. So, yeah. I mean, it's interesting, man, because I kind of been on this getting in shape, you know,
uh-huh.
kind of tip as well, man. I've been doing a lot of jogging and walking
yeah.
and trying to do the best I can to cut down on like eating a lot of sugar and drinking a lot of soda.
Which is hard.
It's hard. It's hard.
Just sugar is in everything.
Right, right. It's hard.
It's hard. It's hard.
Yeah. But they say if you can just change one or two things in your diet, it'll make a major difference.
Yeah, but we cut out the soda.
And weight loss and shape and things like that. So I've been, you know, just trying to lift weights a little bit, do some jogging. I normally would ride a bike, but sometimes you got to do it manually. Mm-hmm. And it's been going well, man. It's been going well. And it's even better when you start to see the results. You know what I mean?
Nice.
So I've been doing that, man. Just trying to stay as fit as I can and look as young and youthful as I can for as long as I can. So, you know, we can get them rolls, man.
I know that's right.
Look, yes. Get them rolls. And then other than that, man, I wrapped up the substitute as well.
Uh-huh.
And that went real, real well. Once again, it was this angle, that angle, this angle, that angle.
That's right. That one take Drake. Listen. Yeah, one take Drake.
Yeah.
Listen, rap, and on to the next one.
That's it. And I wrapped up my final scene for season 3 of Old Head.
Nice.
It's
going to
be good. It's going to be real, real good. Check out Old Head on YouTube. The Old Head TV series, man. It is dynamic. It is great. It is awesome. And other than that, man, we always feel like we got something coming up.
Always.
We're looking forward to those things that are coming up. You know what I mean? And so we continuing to audition and online submissions and those things that we already have coming up. We just waiting to do our part.
Yeah, that's so it. You get the bell for working out. Give yourself the bell.
Did I ring it right?
You gotta shake it. You gotta shake it like a salt shaker. Like
oh that. Man, they sound the same to me anyway. But yeah, so it's been great, man. But listen, I'm excited about our special guest.
Yes.
I'm very, very excited about our special guest, as I am all our guests. But
yes,
I'm excited about our special guest. He is a very, very multi-talented. He's a multi-talented guy, man.
Nice.
He's got a lot of talent. I mean, he's been in some major projects. He knows the acting business,
nice.
The directing business, the writing. He knows the casting. And I'm sure our listeners are going to greatly benefit from his knowledge and experience.
Well, if he's been in some major products, he gonna have to plug that so we can buy some
major projects. I'm sorry. But then again, a project is a product too, you know, if you want to stretch it that
you
way,
you know, like the hair grease.
He's been in commercials too, so he's been in a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
but he's an awesome talent. I actually have deemed him part of what I call, it's just my rendition, it's my opinion,
what?
The Acting Justice League. You got Brian A. Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
You got our special guest,
uh-huh,
which we're going to reveal when we come back from our break. You got Nikee Dillard.
Uh-huh.
You got Keith Bullard. Come on now.
Kevin D. Benton.
Okay, come on now. You get the bell.
Yes.
So, yeah, man. And I'm just excited. So, what we going to do is we going to take a break. And when we come back, how they say in church, the next voice you're going to hear
is none other than the good doctor.
The good doctor. Eminent. Preeminent. Best Bruteros.
Yes.
These are all the words you can't spell.
Hit the tambourine.
Woo!
Yeah. the Shaolin app. If you meet a killer bee on the MIC with the SS double double U in the B. Let me see if we all in together now. Make it move better now. Listen, I ain't sweating no competition. Flow, going back low like I'm fishing.
Another chapter from the Wu-Tang book. Take a look and repeat. Killer bees never sleep. Now stop, put you on the chopping block. Unorthodox, attitude to melt the
pot. I'll do anything, I'm so into you. Right here, I'm weak downtown with the weird.
Boom, kaboom.
Guess who stepped in the room? The SS double double U.
Killer bee on the MIC.
The killer bees coming at you on the MIC. The killer bees. The killer bees.
Yo, you got it. Kaboom.
Kaboom. In the room. Yo, I tell you, you gotta love the Wu-Tang Clan.
Get it out.
No, that was SWV and the Wu. Come on now.
Kaboom.
Come on. Guess who stepped in the room?
The child.
The cow. What does the cow mean?
I don't know.
I want to ask Method Man that if I ever see him. What does the cow? It sounds good, though. It'll work. But anyway, we are back. This is the Kevin and Nikki Show. We on iHeartRadio and a whole lot of other stations and places.
Yeah.
Basically, we everywhere.
Yeah.
But I want to start by introducing our special guest.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're going to hear from him. He is none other than the multi-talented Atif Lanier. He's actor, producer, writer, casting director, and he's even a personal trainer. So if you need to get in shape, he is the man to say. We got to ring the
yes!
bell.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
You get the bell.
All right, just to read off some of his credits, he was in Underground Kings.
Mm-hmm.
He played in The Amazing Spider-Man 2, The Best Man Holiday, Blue Bloods, Do No Harm, All My Children. We got to sing ding, 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 ding. Is that All My Children?
I don't know. I don't watch
do,
it.
Do, 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 do. That it might be. It's one of them. Anyway, Law and Order Special Victims Unit, American Gangster, The Wire. He's been in Invincible, Get Rich or Die Tryin with 50.
50.
Shadow Boxer, Trip and Mary Jane, If It Ain't Got That Swing, and much, much more.
If it ain't got that swing.
Do I, do I, do I, do I, do I, do I, do I. Atif Lanier, are you there? What's up, man? How you doing, man?
I can't complain, man.
I got you, man. I got you. I hear you. I know that's right. Hey, man, thank you, thank you, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Yes.
And, man, it's going to be a lot of fun. And, yeah, man, we grateful to have you on the show, man.
Thanks for having me, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, most definitely.
Nice,
most
nice, definitely. Nice.
Well, look, we're going to jump right in.
Let's jump right on in.
Go ahead,
Nick. Okay, so actor, casting director,
producer,
personal trainer, producer, all of that. So tell our listeners how a little bit about how you got started. Let's go with acting.
Let's start
first.
Yeah, we gotta start
how that. You got started in acting.
Well, acting is very simple. First and foremost, this may sound crazy, but growing up, I had no respect for acting. I thought it was corny.
Okay.
Seriously.
Wow.
Okay. So basically, fast forward to I'm in my early 20s, and basically back then, when I was in my early 20s back then, and I was, I went to church one night, on a hubbub one night, you know, you don't go to church during the week, I mean, you don't go on the weekend, so basically what happened was a lady to church, and she asked on the flyer, she said to me, she's like, I like the way, you know, good look, she said, you should come audition for my play.
Okay.
And I was like, well, I'm not into plays like that. I said, please don't do it for me. I was like, but if anything, I said I would just be interested in being there, just say one line, step on, step off. So basically, I auditioned for the play, and I thought nothing of it. At the time, at that point in time in my life, I was 21. I was playing football. I was playing semi-pro football. So I remember that we were practicing week against weekend. I mean, it's just like an adult league. You know, it sounds better than it really is.
Anyway, I hear you.
She said she was like when she called me in my apartment, came back from a game. She was like, She said, by the way, it's a lady, you got that part in the play. I said, it's perfect. Did I get to what I asked for? Like, that part, just step on and step off, right? She was like, no, you had the part where you could, you're gonna be the protagonist. I said, well, protagonist means it's the main character, right? She was like, yeah. And I said, well, I don't know if I can do that, because I can't fully commit to being in play like that. She said, why is that? You got something going on? And I said, yeah, I'm a football player. She was like, oh, my bad. See, I didn't realize it interfered with your NFL dreams. Well, I said, I'm not going to the NFL. She was like, well, you're not going to the NFL. See you next week at rehearsal. And I'm like, okay. And I remember sitting there thinking, during that week, leading up to the following game, I was sitting there thinking, like, I said this guy, one of my teammates, he's older than me at the time. He was like in his 30s. I said, yeah, let me ask you a question. He said, well, I said, what do most people end up doing who play in this league? He was like, well, they play through love. Some people get picked up and go to higher, like, you know, some people make it all the way to, you know, the highest level. You know, most people just play for the love of the game.
Right.
And I said, so you're trying to tell me there's no, like, end game in this thing? He was like, end game is when you know, you're tired of playing. And when he told me that was, like, my deciding factor. I was like, you know what? I'm going to rehearsal. You know what
I'm saying? I got you. Right.
So as that, you know, I kind of got into it from there. And it kind of also the same thing producing writing. When I started reading a script, I said, I can do this. I started reading, I said, this is not as hard as I thought either. This is, that's actually easier to me. I said, I can write the script. It's pretty simple. So it kind of, from there, is like the birth of me basically, you know what I'm saying, getting into performing arts and everything.
Okay. Cool.
Nice.
Cool, man. Nice. Yeah. So you have a very, very extensive resume, and I kind of look at it like you didn't totally have to give up your NFL dreams, mm-hmm. because you played an NFL player, one of the New York Giants, and
I've been 10 years of football stuff. It's funny how people always say this, like, stuff comes back. I think you heard earth stuff come back to you, but I mean, for 10 years of my life, every fall and spring, I've been doing football, so I'm in full contact. I always tell people this point in time, I need attention.
Right.
Wow.
Right.
Right.
You were taking a picture with you. Yeah, I mean, I was kind of wondering, like, okay, you played in the Best Man Holiday, you played the New York Giants defensive back,
mm-hmm.
and how much, I don't know if I want to use the word vindication or resolve did that give you, you know, maybe not playing in the NFL, but kind of doing it through the medium of acting, you know what I'm saying, because...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
People that over the years you might have seen on TV,
mm-hmm.
you might have seen on TV or read about them.
Right.
And it's like really weird. Like you go to class all the time. I never been to an NFL game, but I can't go to one now because I've been in all the stadiums. It's a locker room.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
yeah.
Like, yo, I know what's going on downstairs, man. I can't be up here, man. I'm going crazy.
Right.
Right.
Yes, it was a level of vindication because I was a
That's right. That's right, man. That's what's up. Yeah, that's what's up.
Nice, nice.
Awesome.
Now, you've also been in The Wire.
The Wire.
Tell, you know, and we had the pleasure of having
Nikee Diller, Brian A. Wilson, and now, yes, Atif Lanier.
Yes, yes, yes. So tell us a little bit about your experience on The Wire.
I'm going to tell you something. I think that was the realest you've ever been on, because what happened was, The Wire is like, they had a set, I mean, they have a set like where you can like, out of Columbia, Maryland, they had like a sound stage.
Yeah.
But a lot of times they had something where like, he was out in the realest, grimiest, dirtiest part of Baltimore. They would like tell you, you know, you would walk up. It was kind of scary because you had real cats from the neighborhood, you know, just there. I mean, it was real. Like the last time I was there was back in 2006. And the last time I was there, I was actually beating up, I don't know if you guys watched The Wire, but
oh, yeah.
Guy, yeah.
Yeah.
Bodie, remember Tech Bodie?
Yep.
Yeah.
I was actually, my job was to beat him up and slam him on a police car and put him in cuffs.
Yeah.
And while we were there, the real police were actually there, but they had to leave because somebody got murdered.
Oh,
they
wow.
Like, you go on your own. You're kind of sitting there like, it's dark, and you're like, yo, and you're a bunch of Hollywood people. You know what I'm saying? You got a film crew, and they're like, yo,
Right.
It's like, what can we do? And that's how it was. It was the grimiest, dirtiest spots in the world.
Wow.
But they filmed it, and they made it real. I mean, it was realistic. They were telling me how, the one guy told me when he first started The Wire, there were some corners that like, you know, real drug dealers had, and real drug dealers came and said, like, look, I'm going to tell you like this. Y'all gotta leave because y'all messing my business.
Right, gotcha.
Wow. They said some of the key piece some of these guys had to give them money. And that's what one guy said. The one key said, we had to actually give these guys money because, in essence, I mean, you're really infringing upon their operation.
They're blocked, yeah.
It looks illegal and everything, but you got a situation that if this dude is not getting his money, he's gonna be like, look, I'm gonna make things a little hectic for you because I'm not getting paid.
Right.
They said they were giving them, like, I mean, obviously, it's not the money you get from.
Right. Listen, for our listeners out there, we are talking to Atif Lanier. He is a very, very decorated actor, producer, writer, casting director, personal trainer, and much, much more. What you're getting right now is exclusive behind the scene.
The Wire
conversation about mm-hmm, The Wire.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's we never knew that.
No, we did not.
Yeah, we never knew that. Like, don't y'all know this is just acting? You know? Right.
Wow.
Now, let me ask you this. Did y'all have to sign papers that y'all filming at your own risk? Okay.
You know, police would be there, but what happens is that, I mean, it's at the same time, it's like, it's only a certain amount of police there, but like I said, I mean, it was like, I just can't describe the vibe when these real cats coming out, these, look, I've never seen, oh, this is like the Baltimore, but I've never seen urban blight like that.
Okay.
Wow.
I mean, there was some serious urban blight, like you, like, they would pick you up in the van, like, you would, you know, get your outfit and, you know, your production would take you to set. But you go out through Baltimore and you go through four blocks and there was no houses that would have that whole four blocks. But you go to one house and it's one person, and literally four blocks, there's one person in this thing. And it's like the rest of the houses are uninhabitable, or so you saw it. There was, like, squatters in there and everything.
Okay,
so,
wow.
I mean, the urban blight. It's nothing like it. It really is nothing. Has nothing to urban blight. That was a serious urban blight. But I'm saying for whatever they were showing the show, because honestly, to be frank, people laugh. I don't really watch The Wire. But I guess the whole the what they're looking for, they found that, like I said, the grimiest, you know, most bombed out spots.
Right. Yeah.
Like, look, you're gonna set up here, but you know, the urban whatever. Those grimy spots are usually where, you know, cats are be out there. Like, this is a perfect opportunity for me to set up my.
Right. And you know, to your point, man, I think that was one of the things that made the show so authentic because, you know, we're looking at this thing on HBO, and we're like, yo, that set is realistic.
Right, and to your point, some of the areas... some of the areas, you would think that they set it up like that, but right. He's saying, no, that was the way it was.
No, it was just really what it was. I remember, like I said, the same night when that first got murdered, there was this house next to us, right? Mm-hmm. I remember we sitting there thinking, it had cobwebs all over it, had dust all over it, and suddenly when the cops pulled off, a light came on, and somebody went up to me, what's going on here? And I was like, somebody lives there.
Mm. Wow.
Wow, that's crazy.
Now
look, I gotta ask you. You played on All My Children, and you know how they make fun of. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Oh, that's what's up, man. Hey, look, it's hard to get on those soap operas.
Yes, it is.
So that's a heck of an achievement. Whether you got one word, one line, under five or over five, but how you know how they make fun of these. Soap opera, I remember Eddie Murphy said I had to read a lot of Hallmark cards. You know, how did you prepare for like your characters in terms of bringing about that? Yeah.
Okay.
You just called. Okay, got you.
Under five. So under five was like, you literally, by the union rules, you only have five lines.
Got you.
So I did that. And then maybe like a month later, it was crazy, which this is hot to me. Like maybe like a month later, he called me in to be, six months later, he called me in. I was a fireman, had a few lines then. And the last time I was on there, I was security guard.
Okay.
Was like, look, I Atif, he said, listen, he said, we're going out of business as we know it. He said, I'm trying to get everybody on. He was like, I like you. Yeah, he said, do you want to come on again? I said, sure. He was like, what will it be? He said, security guard. And he said, just stay in line for me, man. What are you doing? I said, man, what are you doing? He said, all right, send me a script. And it was with Eric Kane, the famous lady Eric Kane.
Uh-huh. Yes.
I didn't know she was until, yeah, just basically what happened when she was coming in. I said, man, what are you doing? I grabbed her up. And we went back and forth a few times. But again, I can only say a certain amount of things because once I went over certain lines, you know, they had to pay you.
Right,
I mean,
right.
If that was today, that'd be different because it wouldn't matter because you're just going to be a day player no matter what. But after back doing separate entity, they had this strict rule. You had to stay only on a total of five lines.
Got you.
And they had to pay you more.
That's good. That's good. That's good knowledge right there. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yep, sure is.
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome. I know a lot of people trying to get on them soap operas.
Yeah, look, I go on there and say one word like, what?
Yeah.
Right.
People home now instead of watching, you know, growing up in like our parents' generation, when you watch the soap opera, that wasn't those realities.
Right.
Stuff going on. But now it's kind of like you really watching people do scandalous stuff on TV because they don't need the soap operas.
Right.
Like, yo, I can just watch this stuff on TV and be scandalous. So that's the latest movie because what happened was after that, I got, I want to say it was at the World Turns, a lady.
Okay.
I went on this for her and she was like really happy. And she was like, we got something going on there. She was like, well, she was like, there's no shooting anymore. So why? She said, we just pulled the plug.
Oh, wow.
There was like, every day she came to work, somebody's office was cleared out because they were cleaning out. And she was like, I hope he's on before it happened. And she called me. She's like, you're one of the last phone calls I'm making before you rip the phone out. Just like, okay, she told me.
Wow,
that's crazy.
Yeah.
Now, Get Rich or Die Tryin, of course, with you on there with 50 Cent. Tell our listeners a little bit about that experience.
Well, basically what happened was, strangely enough, this is weird, that's the movie I got upgraded on.
Initially, nice.
What happened was, I was initially, I was in school for biology, so I used to be a contractor for a long time, a contractor pharmaceuticals for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember what happened was, I was SAG, I was back in, I didn't join the union, I was getting a lot of non-union work, it was great, but what happened was, when you're a contractor, you can obviously take off work and you know how to work and get paid, which is good.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, what happened with me was around June of 2005, they told me my contract was ending. I'm kind of like, I was like, whoa, I didn't anticipate not having a job. So I remember what happened was, I was trying to find a job, another contract. And I remember this lady sent an email out. I remember that email come out saying, we're looking for extras for the untitled 50 Cent movie. And I was like, well, if I can't find a job right now, it's going to be extra work, you know, keep some money out of pocket while we're looking for a job.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember what happened was I got booked to be an extra. And I remember, like, I was there for, like, a three-day, you know, they usually get you a couple of days. I remember the first day I was there, it was cool, the second day I was there. And they called me, like, you know, I remember as clear as day, they said, the lady called me, said, you want to go back next week? And I was like, well, I'm not really. I said, I want to go next week. I said, I got this job pending. And she was like, they called for an interview and took an interview. She was like, well, she said, it's 5 o'clock in the evening. That was Friday. She's like, just go ahead and go ahead. She said, just go. I said, fine. But she didn't sound like this. I'm at Friday. I said, so, but then I woke up that Monday. I was, you know, I was down in the Pennsylvania, Philly area. It was raining real bad and everything. I said, you know what? I'm not going. I'm just, I called her cell phone. And it's back in 2005, so obviously a little different then. And it kept going to voicemail. And finally, she called me, was like, hello? She called back, she said, Atif, where are you? I said, I'm home. She said, wait a minute, don't you live in Pennsylvania? I said, yeah, I'm in Pennsylvania. She said, you're supposed to be in New York right now. I said, look, it's driving, raining out here. I said, yeah, it's not worth it. I'm not going to go. And she was like, no. You already signed and committed to this, you need to go. So we went back and forth. And finally, I go to New York. I get to New York. It's really weird. I get there in the middle of the rain. I got the wrong address. This is, like I said, this whole day was crazy. I got the wrong address. I'm in Manhattan. I'm back to Manhattan. I'm like, yo, I'm supposed to be in the Bronx.
Oh, wow. You was a couple barrels over.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I was sitting there. It was so bad. I couldn't. This is back in the day before cell phones. You know, you did a fan thing. I couldn't get on my email. I had to call my friends who I trust. I said, listen, I need to go on my email. Give me the address. And I said, information transfer. I said, look at this address when she gave it to me. This is before GTS. Obviously, no GTS back then.
Right.
I drove down 9th Avenue all the way to the Bronx.
Wow.
I get to the Bronx, and I'm lying when I got to the Bronx. This story, you don't understand. This story talked about earlier. I didn't Bronx by like 12. I'm supposed to be there. I'm supposed to be in the Bronx probably at crawl time, supposed to be at 9 o'clock. So think about that. 3 hours. So So anyway, I walk in, it's raining, he's pouring. I walk to this, like a fire hall area, I walk past the TA. He said, what's your name? I said, he said, oh man, you must go home. I said, why? He said, just be on the way. I said, have you done anything yet? He was like, well, not really, but you're late. And I said, okay, fine. He said, never mind. He said, no, just go sit down. I sat down for no more than 2 minutes, I need some breakfast. And all of a sudden, she said, come here. I said, what? I got up, I said, what do you want? He said, come with me. I said, yo. I'll just go home, man. Okay, it's fine. I go, I'll just go home. I said, well, that's fine, right? He said, come with me. And we walked outside in the rain. I was sitting there walking down the street, right in the L, in the Bronx, the L. And the streets was pouring. I was sitting there. I was so angry, like, the water was like, I couldn't, at the time, see them. I had steam, you know what I'm saying? I walked down the street, and there's two guys in the corner standing there. He was like, stand right here. I'm sitting there, I'm yelling, I'm cursing, oh my God, what are you doing here? It's freaking raining out here, it's middle of July. And also the director walks to us, all three of us, right? He saw me being the most animated. You know, kids wise, the most animated person, standing was yelling and screaming. He was like, Irish said, he's a young man. But see, the problem is, it's raining, I got no coat on, I freeze the rain, it's July. I said, what are you doing out here? And I'm saying, I start pulling my fists and stuff, I'm really pissed off. He said, very animated, aren't you? I said, okay. He said, tell me a story. I said, story? I'm trying to give you a reason to tell you a story. You know what I'm saying? He was like, man. And I told him, whatever. He said, what are you doing Saturday night? And I just told him something funny. He's like, can you tell the same story three times? I was like, what? I don't understand. What are we talking about? He said, tell it three times. He said, why are you telling it three times? He said, because we're going to use that in the movie.
Oh, wow.
I kind of was perplexed. And I was like, what? And so he said, and the other guy, the PA, said, that's what I was trying to tell you to calm down. He said, every day we watch the dailies since you've been here. He said, you're a pretty big dude. And he said, we saw you in the background. He said, the director said, that guy's too big. I can't have any dialogue.
Right. Wow. So your presence.
They said, so what we're going to do is, he said, we're going to give you a dialogue in this movie. I said, I started to calm down. So basically, here, watch it, Richard Die Tryin' again. It's a very, they cut it down. It's a very small part. I still residuals for it. But this is part of the movie when 50 Cent goes from being a little boy to an adult, and he's sitting there pointing a gun in the mirror. And next thing you know, they do a wipe of the screen, and they show walking on the street. There's a guy in the street. He's walking three guys, and you see me in the middle. I'm telling the story. When he comes up to us, I like stop and look at him, and I'm looking at him like he's crazy. He looks at me, and he just keeps on the street. They put music over my lines, but I still got
nothing,
you know, wasn't for it.
Okay.
Right.
My point is, it's like that was a day that obviously, because from the jump, like I told you, I woke up, well, I didn't say woke up at 5 o'clock, I just didn't like go anywhere, but I'm just going to stay home all day and be there looking for a job. That's what I'm saying I'm doing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to go to New York. Like I said, when that happened, I was just so stunned because I was like, wow, because even then, that was my first time as a SAG person, having a role with speaking at SAG.
Right.
I remember meeting when I got there, they immediately ushered me off set. Like, they took me in a role, they gave me this, like, 3-page contract. Mm. And I just looked at it, and I signed it, and they said, you gotta go, because you're done for the day. Boom. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And a few weeks later, I'll be like, yo, next week, I got, like, this big check, and I was like,
yeah. I know that's right. Right.
So I was
kind of
like,
that
was a blessing.
I got you. I know that's right.
That was the day to show you. I didn't plan that. I just want to be home all day.
Right. Nice. Well, man, I got to talk about Trippin' Mary Jane and If It Ain't Got That Swing. And I definitely, man, got to give you a shout out because, you know, you gave me an opportunity to be in the movie. I came out to the MLK Center audition. I was just dressed in my 1950s, 1960s outfit. I had my suspenders, my fedora.
Let's tell the audience more about it. Because you was like a hitman.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's like, yo,
this
shit. I was like, yo, this
girl,
she's calling me.
Yeah, man. And you... I was being persistent, man.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you, man. Yeah, I definitely appreciated the opportunity and, you know, how you, you know, was working with me in the audition and gave me the adjustments and stuff like that, man. And the rest was history, man. And I remember the scene that we did. We was, I mean, we was grinding like 2-3 in the morning. You know, shout out to Mike A. Pender. I got to give him a shout out, the director. And we was just out there grinding, man. The scene turned out very, very well. And, yeah, man, it's like... Right, right.
So that guy was like, fine, good at night. And I said, we're going to find out what to do this because we tell them we overnight shoot. Because what happened was initially we started telling people, it's like, look, we're going to shoot August 1st. They was like, oh, you mean? No, I said, August 1st, the 2nd. They couldn't understand. And I said, what that means is this. That means you show up at night, it's going to be August 1st. We leave, we're August 2nd.
Right, right, right. That's right. Yeah, it was. And man, and it's winning film festival awards all across the world. Swing is globetrotting right now. Right, right.
We basically said that we said, people said, you know, when the next episode, we would have family episode. That's interesting. I said, what are we looking at the topic? So, I know you cast the first one, so, you know, I'm sorry, I'm trying to pitch the next one. But we're doing episode, but like I said, your episode is your win. Yes, it did win up. We won an award in St. Lucia, and we won an award.
Nice.
Great stuff.
Yeah. Now, I want to flip the conversation a little bit because you're also a personal trainer. And
yes.
Kevin and I have been on our fitness journey.
We just got on this week.
We just got on this week. And I bought a stepper and I did 600 steps. I Google said that I had to burn 500 calories a day. I thought I was doing great. Got on the stepper, 600 steps, and only burned 100 calories. So I'm getting ready to write my letter to Google and let them know they lied to me. But I want to hear what you got to say about that.
What help can you give us?
So first of all, here's the biggest thing like this. First of all, you got to throw away some of the stuff you use. Some of the stuff you see in the store away. First and foremost, I tell people I have a roster of clients and also right now a contract with university for fitness.
Okay.
Here's the thing. You gotta remember, first and foremost, everybody works out with me. I ask them what they're looking to do. Because what happens is that people have this idea like, you know, guys used to look on TV and see all the social media, I want to be just like him or whatever. But the thing about it is the method by which you take to get there.
Right.
So you have these things where people say these machines, equipment, like, oh, I'm gonna get you this, you know, both flash and all that. Dude, first of all, people in commercial don't use that stuff to begin with. So put it out the window. You see the guy in the Bowflex, he all built, he eating real weights. But he's sitting there tall, he's a Bowflex, but he's a model.
He was in shape before he used the Bowflex.
Exactly.
Right.
So what happens is that if you try to lose weight, sure, let my clients do. Usually, we say like a machine. They start off on like an elliptical. They warm an elliptical, but then we work out. We do things like, so what happens is like they might get on, I do reps, like 12 reps. They're burning, you know, 12 reps. I do like 12, 8, 6, 12 reps, 8 reps, 6 reps. I increase the weight, what have you. So my thing about it is strength training happens because you're building muscle, and muscle in essence burns fat, and muscle keeps your calories high because that's going to make you lose weight. Because you, if you lose muscle too, your body has to go down because you don't need them. It's not going to be, your body feels there's no need to upkeep this because there's nothing there. I'm trying to put it in simple terms instead of me pulling out my egghead terms.
I got you. I got you.
If you want to lose weight, don't even step up, okay? Change the diet, okay? And like I said, you got to change the diet. So then look at, there's a big thing called biofeedback. What's biofeedback? Biofeedback is typically how do you feel after you're doing certain activities, but also, or eat certain things. So for example, if you eat cake, right?
Uh-huh.
You eat a chocolate cake, you would sit there and feel fat and nasty, right? Because you are, because basically just like a whole bunch of sugar, y'all have insulin in your blood right now. It's a bad look. As a parent, you ate something and said, I feel light and free and fancy. You know, same thing with activity. You go to the gym, and I tell you all the time, because I don't make anything they can't do. What does that mean? That means like this. So if somebody says, hey, I want to do squats. Okay, you might want to do squats, but some people can't do squats. Because, for example, if you do a squat, and your knees are grinding, then that means it's just something you can't do.
Mm-hmm.
That's biofeedback. You say, hey, this is not within my scope of activity that I can do. Same thing with food. So these are things you got to see. Yeah, look at, even without a trainer present, they're saying, hey, every time I look at this, my hip hurts. Every time I do this, let's work around that or fix that. Same thing with diet. Some people have allergies. Mm-hmm. Like, somebody will say to you, oh, my knee's bad. Well, take a drink or, you know, glucosamine. But anybody with some allergy can't take either one.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So it's kind of like, so that's what I'm saying. So when you look at those things like on Google like that, look at some kind of authenticity because they'll say certain things, but read a little further than that. If you want to lose weight, it's not an easy, there's no easy fix. That's especially because they have these easy fixes. People want to do that because I have people I work out with and train and stuff. They've all this stuff. They've worked out for years and they haven't done nothing. They worked out for 3 months a lot different from somebody that knows they're doing.
Right.
Okay.
Authenticity, number one, if you research on your own. Number two, how you feel mechanically when you do something. And number three, when you eat something. Those are the three things all the time because I know certain things you myself, I eat it. I just know it's not going to make me feel good.
Right.
This is just not good. Or if I do certain activities, I can't do that for my you know, for me, my back hurt, my knees.
Okay.
So it's kind of like, this is what people have to understand. But people are sometimes literally killing themselves because they're walking blindly in the woods at night trying to reach them. You know, fit in nirvana, but doing all these things that are just basically counterproductive.
Right.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Okay. Okay.
Got you.
He broke it down.
And that was on the house. Now listen, look, I follow you on Facebook. I watch some of your videos. I gotta actually get in shape just to watch the video, man, because you be going hard. But that was some good information.
Nice.
And that was great stuff.
Nice.
But yeah, man, we. Yeah, absolutely, man. But listen, man, you've been a great guest, man. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Yeah.
We definitely have to have you back, you know, to talk more about acting.
Yes.
Definitely acting in Philly.
Yes.
You're very, very knowledgeable about the business. But before you leave, man, we want you to put your social media, how people can follow you on Facebook, Twitter. If they want to book you for a person, be their personal trainer.
Nice.
You know, I'm telling y'all, he's the real deal.
Nice.
And you might want to, if you're serious about getting in shape and having a healthy lifestyle, you might want to book Atif Lanier. I have seen him. I've seen his work, and it is the truth.
Nice.
So, yeah, put your stuff out there.
Well, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Rahim Lanier. That's on anything. That's on Facebook. That's on Instagram. I think that's what else I on Instagram. Google Plus.
All right.
Yeah. If you like to contact further, talk like you said, anything you said about reference to fitness, reference to film, to acting, by all means, to connect. I definitely would appreciate it.
Yeah, definitely.
Nice.
Well, that's it. That's what they say. Keep it simple, right there.
Keep it simple.
Yeah, man. Thank you so much, man. And
yes.
Like I said, if you're doing anything that you would like for us to promote, that you have coming up, things like that, let us know, man. We'll blast it out. And I mean, we were friends before this, but hey, we tell people all the time that when you come on the Kevin and Nikki show,
now family.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate
that. All right, man. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
I take care.
All right, take care.
Thank you. Bye.
Yeah, take care. That was dope. Look, we got a lot of information.
Real nice.
That was nice. Who said that? Nice. Real nice.
Real nice.
Real nice. That was nice.
He told me, he said, throw away the stepper. What?
Well, since you bought it, I probably wouldn't throw it away. Yeah. Because it can be used. I get what he was saying from a professional training standpoint.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I think that it can be used somewhere in your exercise regimen. You know what I'm saying?
Because technically, I'm not going to get my 500 calories burned on that thing.
Right.
Not unless I step into, I kill over.
Right. Well, you could use it to compliment something. You know what I'm saying? You could use it to compliment, say, weight training or something. It's a place for it.
Definitely. Yeah.
And then, like you said, since you still got the receipt?
I still have it. But it's been a minute, though.
Okay,
yeah,
well, cool.
It's been a minute, so... Yeah, they ain't gonna take that back.
Oh no, I'm not saying take it back.
I'm just saying
you purchased it, so you know
there's a place for it. Like you said, I'm gonna use it along with something else. Maybe use it for my 600 steps and then turn around and get on a spinner because I do have a spinning bike at home.
So you can use a plethora of things that you can work together.
So I can spin to the Kevin and Nikki show.
Yeah. But you know what? I mean, he said a lot of things. He pointed out a lot of points. I love the story of perseverance. And how he eventually got to the set of Get Rich and Die Trying, starring Fitty.
Yes.
And got upgraded. But he had every reason how the day was going to say, I'm not going to take this trip.
Yeah.
And it just goes to show you that one time that you don't feel like it, but press your weight anyway, that could be the one. So he went from, and we talk about this all the time. We don't turn down no roles. Because you can always get upgraded. You never know what will happen. And he got it under five rain.
But I can see how he felt, though, because it's pouring down rain. And you got to drive all the way to New York, and you at the wrong address at that.
But here's the thing. I definitely hear you. I'm just happy that the end result, or the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, was getting a desired result.
I was waiting for him to say that he knocked somebody out.
I thought that was coming.
Yeah. I thought he was going to say, I was getting ready to punch it up. It's raining, and I just drove all the way down here, and you're telling me to go home because I'm late?
Right. That was dope. That was dope.
Who he sound like, though?
Who's that?
Our guest from last week. He drove 5 hours.
Oh, yeah. I ain't drive all the way down here. Yeah. I got you, man.
That was great stuff, man.
Yeah, but he's been in some projects, man.
Yeah.
And I like how he laid out that rule with the under five, because it's changed now.
I didn't know that.
That was powerful.
That was good.
Good information.
Because I learned something today.
Yeah, because if you went over the five lines, then they had to pay you as a day player. And I never knew that either.
Right.
So the rules kind of changed.
Throwing out the
what's up. But you know what? And that's one thing I love about, like, Nikee Diller, he stays on top of the business part of the acting. And I think that's just so important. You know what I mean? We got to know the rules.
Yeah.
We got to know what's going on so that we know what we have, what we're entitled to.
Yeah, Nikee are funny, though. Every time he see me, we will be on set together. Right. He like, Nikee, what's up with that sag?
What's up with that sag?
I'm coming. Just let me get the breakout role first.
Right.
You know, I got to have some ducats to back that up.
Right. And some of you got to build up your IMDb credits.
Y'all got to build it up.
Build your resume.
Listen. I'm going wait.
Right.
Until the midnight hour. What's that song? I'm gonna wait till the midnight hour. That's all I do. I'm gonna wait till the midnight hour to be sad.
Yeah. All right. So
let's go hop on into news and sports.
News and sports. All right. So look, in sports, y'all already know. The Villanova Wildcats defeated the Michigan Wolverines to capture the national championship. The parade was in Philly.
Yeah.
It was off the chain. It was off the hook. Shout out once again to Jay Wright, the whole Villanova men's basketball team. And my little bro, Damir Cosby, Roundtree, number 21. And he's only a freshman. He's a national champion, man.
Nice.
I seen this guy go from Pepper Playground pickup games
to
playing in the Philadelphia Legends basketball league that me and NBA legend Lewis Lloyd reffed.
Yes.
To Newman Garetti.
Nice.
To state champion.
Nice.
To Villanova.
Nice.
To national champion.
Nice.
It don't get
he
the
get the
he
bell.
He gotta get the bell, yo. He gotta get the bell.
Yes.
Yeah. And
go ahead.
I'm gonna speak it right now. Next stop, NBA.
NBA.
He's going to the NBA. You heard it here NBA. First on the Kevin Nikki Show.
On iHeartRadio.
You know.
Yeah.
That's it for sports.
All right, I'm going. News is going to be quick.
Okay.
News, man. Listen, they got to do something about the Second Amendment.
Okay.
They got to do something about it. I'm telling you right now. Another shooting. Yahoo company. Mm-hmm. Young lady decides that she don't like the rules and the regulations of the company. She decides to go in and start shooting.
On her job.
On her job. Kills two to three people and herself.
Okay.
And story tells that it doesn't seem like she knew the people that she shot.
Okay.
But she was so upset, Kev, with the rules, the regulations, the laws, and all that other kind of stuff. You know how every job got laws and different things that, you know, the employees have to abide by.
Right.
She doesn't like it.
Okay.
So she decided to voice her opinion with the gun.
Well, you know what? I want to contribute to this because whenever you see behavior like that, it doesn't sound like she learned about those rules on that day and decided to shoot. You know, to me, that sounds like a progression that led to, that type of behavior, extreme behavior. And you know, we don't know all the details in terms of what she was going through. We're not condoning violence at all. But, I mean, was there any kind of workplace bullying going on? Were there people enforcing the rules against certain employees and not against her? Was there any kind of injustice going on? I don't know.
Look.
I don't know.
Look. Damn that. Okay.
I hear you.
You got an issue. You take that up with the people that you got an issue with. Why you got to take innocent people with you?
Right. I got Nick. What I'm saying to you is I'm not condoning violence. I'm talking about when you see behavior like that, it just is always a buildup.
I mean, why didn't she, if you don't like the rules and the regulations of your job, why don't you just quit?
Right. And what I'm saying, I'm not excusing or qualifying her actions.
Right.
I'm just saying it sounded to me that it was more going on that led to her making that drastic decision and then to kill herself.
Yeah.
You know, it seemed like something was going on, man. And, you know, we talk about bullying and stuff with the kids. And we know that they learn it. They get that model from their parents. And we do know that one of the things that's going on in our country that's it's an epidemic that needs to be addressed is workplace bullying.
Something workplace bullying, all of that. Something has to be done. There has to be stricter gun laws in place to keep things like this from happening.
Right.
So you don't like what's going on at your job, so now you want to go and she went postal.
Right. I got you.
Come on now.
Listen, I'm right there with you. I'm just saying, you know, because my psychology is kicking in now. My education is kicking in, and I know that when I hear about something like that, there's normally a progressive building up. You know, unresolved hurt leads to anger, bitterness, resentment, wrath, rage, revenge. It's a progression. And, you know, I start thinking about things like, could there have been anything along that path of progression to revenge that could have been preventative? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That could have been preventative. Like, we can't be looking at video cameras on the back end of people dying.
Yeah.
What preventative measures can we take? What kind of, you know, things can be put in that makes employees feel protected from workplace bullying, harassing, targeting, and things like that? So it's an all around problem. You got the gun laws. You got people who are just, you know, have been moved or pushed to certain limits where they, you know, take measures like these. You have, you know, what is human resources doing?
Yeah.
Did anybody see signs leading up? You know, that's what a psychologist would be thinking about, you know, in totality. So I definitely understand, hear what you're saying. I agree with what you're saying. Something has to be done.
Something has to be done. Because it got to stop.
Right.
It has to stop. We have to have stricter laws set in place to prevent people from just carrying guns.
Right, right.
You know?
Well, it's not as much the carrying of the guns as the people who are carrying the guns.
You know what I mean.
You
know, we have to have some stricter laws set in place. You know, it got to happen.
Right. It has to happen, and it needs to happen now. Right, and
we
got to stop waiting for something to happen to start evaluating and, you know, things like that, because, you know, it's like, it doesn't seem like preventative measures is the priority. It's like, okay, something happened, let's march, let's protest, and now let's give attention to the cry of the people.
Exactly.
So, yeah, something has to be done, man. Something definitely has to be done.
Well, that's all I have.
We're going to take a break?
We're going to take a break.
All right.
And when we come back, it's going to be time for
What's Bothering Nikki? Mm-hmm. What's Bothering Nikki?
To the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. Yes.
All right. You gotta love Luther. Never too much. Why you stop?
Okay. Never too much. Never too much. Never too much. It's not for too much.
that, man. We ain't playing that. We didn't even plan that. This is unscripted, y'all.
You know what?
We did it. You got to admit it. We did it that time. That was nice, though. That was nice. That sounded nice.
You know what? You are a mess.
Yo, it's look, I joined in. I had to join in. That was dope, though. That was dope. It sounded good.
You laugh. Yo, listen, man. You guys. I truly enjoy this show.
Yo, but you gotta admit, that did sound good, though.
That was good.
We didn't plan that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you never know what you're gonna get on the Kevin Nikki show.
You never know.
You might get some singing, impersonation.
I don't even know.
You know.
I don't even know.
So when we get it, y'all get it. But thank you to all our listeners all over the world, all over the country that are listening, tuning in. We greatly, greatly appreciate you. From the top, middle, and bottom of our hearts, we're serious. We do what we do for you. And we enjoy what we're doing, as y'all can tell.
Yes.
You know. Yes. So we just be having too much fun because we have too much
too
time.
Much, on. Never too, too much, much, never too much, much, never too much,
never too much. Oh, you got that was that. Yo, I hit that note. I can't sing, but I hit that note. Don't even try.
Listen, what were the words that you said? What were the words?
What were the words? Never too much.
Yeah, what'd you say after that?
Heart fire?
No, it's oh my love.
I want to sing it the way I want to sing
it. Now you rewriting Luther's song.
I got to rewrite Luther's song, man.
Do it a 1, 2, 3. Too much, never too much, never too much, never
heart
too much.
Heart fire.
You know what?
Heart fire. You know when you don't know the words, you got to make stuff up. You know what I mean?
Listen, my cheeks are hurting right now.
Oh, man, that's funny, man. That was fun.
Wow.
But anyway, it is time for my favorite part of the show. It's time for What's Bothering Nikki? What's bothering you, Nick?
Well, here's the thing. I put up a post on our Facebook page, and I asked some of our friends to our show, what's bothering them?
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? Got a response.
Okay.
Pat!
What's up, Miss Pat?
Yes. She said that what's bothering her is people who are nasty. So we're going to revisit.
I got you.
We're going to revisit. People, why are you so nasty?
Why y'all so nasty?
Why are you so nasty? You know, don't have... And she said they don't have nothing nice to say to nobody. Ooh, didn't we talk about this
before? Sure.
Yes. Pat want us to talk about why are people so nasty?
Now,
why are people so rude? Don't have nothing nice to say. So let's dig on into it.
Now, wasn't the old saying that if you don't have nothing nice to say,
don't say nothing at all.
Take it away, Nick. Go.
I mean, come on. So what's bothering me and Pat?
And me.
And Kev this week? People, why are you so nasty?
Mm-hmm. Nasty as a rattlesnake.
You know, mean and surly. Don't have nothing nice to say to nobody. People say good morning to you. You know, what's that thing it used to be? If you wake up and you wake up evil, go back to sleep.
Go back to sleep.
Or you woke up on the wrong side of the bed this morning.
Go back to sleep. And get up on the other side.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, come on. Why can't you do that? Why you got to wake up? You know, my thing, remember we said before when we did this topic, if God woke, you know, God wake us up every morning, God wake us up. Be nice.
That's the reason to be happy right there.
Exactly. He doesn't have to. You can find yourself on the south side of the dirt.
That's right.
You know, sleeping.
That's right. I mean, things might not be going all perfect in your life. But if you woke up and you keep waking up, that means the dream is still alive.
Yes, and you still have more time to get it together.
Right, that's right.
Get yourself together.
That's right. Get yourself together.
Come on.
Get your dreams in order. Get your house in order. You know, you can motivate, you can inspire, you can encourage because there's greatness in you. And if you're mean as a rattlesnake and nasty, you just haven't figured it out yet.
Listen, you are blocking your blessing.
There it is. You are
blocking your blessing. The Lord can't bless you, you being nasty.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he can't bless you every time you turn around, you got something evil to say to somebody.
Yeah.
You know, he can't bless you like that.
And then you
got
to be careful, man, because normally our blessings tend to come through another person.
You never know who you're talking to.
That's right. I'm going to tell you, I know a true story of this lady who she would go to church and just mind her business. And you had this group of ladies that would talk about her shoes and all this old stuff. And one of the ladies in the group lost her job.
Mm.
Filled out an application to this particular business. got accepted to the point of being brought in for an interview.
Uh-huh.
Goes into the interview, and guess who's sitting at the table doing the interview?
I like to be a fly on that wall.
The lady who they have been talking about her shoes.
Ooh.
And, oh, you know the lady in the group had to throw out her church card. Pastor told me to tell you hi. And da-da-da-da-da. And did you enjoy the service when he was talking about? And da-da-da-da-da. Because she knows that this lady knows she's been talking about it.
Yes. And she knows she was wrong.
So, the lady, hey, sister so-and-so. Hey, God bless this, that, and the other. The lady who was the owner of the corporation or whatever. Said, hey, her basically when she did the interview. Because she can't discriminate.
Right.
And the last word she heard was, thanks for coming.
Uh-huh.
And she never heard anything else.
That's right. She got so her rejection letter in the mail.
That's right. And so, like Nikki said, you could be blocking your blessing. That person who you don't like might be the key to your next open door.
Yep.
That person who you're talking about could be the key to your next opportunity. That thing you've been waiting on, wishing and wanting, is going to come through a person.
Yep.
And that's why it's so imperative that we treat people how we want to be treated.
Yes, because you never know who you're talking to. You never know who you're talking to. Like Kev said, you never know. You can be talking to the person who God has sent to bless you.
To bless you.
And you're treating that person so nasty.
Right. And sometimes what I've learned, sometimes people, they not going to say nothing to you about who they are or how they can bless you. You just not going to get it. And by the way, it takes more muscles to frown than it does to smile. And smiling is better for your health.
Yeah, what's that song?
Shout out to Pat for answering. Thank you, Miss Pat. All right,
now it's time.
We're going to take a break?
For my favorite part of the show, after the break.
After the break.
Kevin's Corner.
Shake, and quake. After the break. We don't fake, but we just take time to rhyme just like this. We're going to come back and you're going to get with this. Peace. Hey, that came on top of my head. I don't know.
Stops to take a dive and they all go marching down to the boom, 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 boom. The ants go marching 6 by 6, hoorah, hoorah. The ants go marching 6 by 6, hoorah, hoorah. The ants go marching 6 by 6. The little one stops to pick up sticks, and they all go marching down to the ground to get out of the rain. The ants go marching 7 by 7, hoorah. The ground to get out of the rain. The ants go marching 8 by 8. Hoorah, hoorah.
All right.
Yes.
All right. Look, that song could have went all the way up to 100. We had to stop at 8 for Kevin's Corner. We had to stop at 8 for Kevin's Corner.
You know, the beginning of it, it sounds like, you know, that Wakanda beat.
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You may want to boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like,
yeah.
Now it's time for my favorite part of the show. Kevin's Corner.
Yeah, all right.
What's up?
What's up?
What's up? What's up? What's up?
All right. So it's time for Kevin's Corner. It's that time of the show. We just try to motivate, encourage, inspire, make the world a better place, and just address us as human beings holistically. So, just like the song, it was a song about ants, and we stopped at number 8, because it said the ants go marching 8 by 8, and I want to talk about 8 things that we can learn from ants, all right? So, number 1, ants aren't intimidated by the size of their workload, all right? Ants aren't intimidated by the sheer size of the objects that they need to carry, so why should we, all right?
Okay.
All right, number 2. Ants value teamwork, all right? A single ant can only do so much, as strong as they are, but when they work as a team, they are able to achieve greater heights. Ants just don't leave their fellow ants alone when carrying huge objects. They help each other, making it possible for them to achieve their goals.
Working together.
Working together, all right? Number 3, ants are organized. Isn't it amazing how even when there are so many ants carrying a single object, they seem to be moving in the same direction? They are so organized in how they carry out their tasks that they are able to accomplish it no matter how big the task is.
Mm-hmm.
So it's imperative that we bring an element of organization
right.
to our lives.
Right.
All right. Number 4, ants save for rainy days.
Nice.
All right?
Nice.
So I'm sure that even you've seen it yourself. Ants just don't eat on the spot. Even when they see a huge chicken BLT sandwich. Okay, I'm stretching a little bit. But you get the message. All right? They try to carry the food to their ant colony and save up for a rainy day. I think that is imperative that we learn economic strategies and financial strategies such that we should learn to not just spend, but save for a rainy day. And here's a progress towards debt-free tip. Use cash.
Yeah,
Use cash. Instead of charge, because anything you charge now, you're going to have to pay later.
Yeah, you know that term, save for a rainy day, that's old school.
That's right.
You know, our parents used to say that to us all the time.
That's right. They would give us allowance and give us the $5 and teach us to put so much in the piggy bank.
Right.
And it taught us that financial strategy in terms of saving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Number 5, ants get the job done. I've never seen a group of ants leave what they're carrying and just call it a day. They persevere and make sure that they get the job done. You heard Atif's story. He persevered through that hectic day. And at the end of the day, he got the job done.
Yes,
he did. We persevere and finish what we start, because one of the qualities that is indicative of this generation is quitting.
Yeah.
You know, if our children aren't getting enough time on the basketball team, they want to quit. And I remember my freshman year playing JV at Overbrook. I wasn't getting much time, but my dad, no, you're going to finish.
That's right.
We'll reevaluate after the season is over, but you're going to finish this season, or you're going to work your behind off to earn your role.
Nice.
And
nice.
What happened was some of the upperclassmen flunked out during the second period, so I kind of lucked out, got a chance to start, and I ended up leading us in scoring with 12 points a game.
Nice.
But I learned about how not to quit. Be like the ant. get the job done. Nice. And stick with it and stay with it till you get the job done. All right? Ants teach us about ignoring little diversions. And the analogy here is that if you ever see an ant colony moving and you put your finger in front of it, they'll just go around it. They'll rather crawl over it and keep moving. They'll go around it. But one thing they do is they keep moving. Okay? They don't get caught up in all the little diversions, and neither should we. Don't get caught up in the gossip on the job. And you got dreams, goals, and aspirations, people to see, places to go. Don't get caught up in all that stuff that can distract you from where you're going. You know, I heard someone say, don't look to the left, don't look to the right. And I want to add this, just follow the yellow brick road. You know what I mean? For your life.
Nice.
Number 7, ants teach us that the next generation is everybody's responsibility. We talked about this on one of our other shows, how back in the day, the community raised the kids.
Yeah.
But ants raise all their young together, and that's something that we should learn to do too. You know what I'm saying? That's a quality that's missing in today's society, where I know when we were younger, the neighbors were allowed to correct your children.
Right.
They were allowed to say, hey, you shouldn't be running through that yard or things like that. And now we got parents that are going up to the school, cussing the teacher out because your child is swinging from the chandeliers on his cell phone, and all she's trying to do is tell him to take his seat so everybody can learn.
Yeah.
All right? Yeah. So we need to get back to community, man. You know, the kids in the neighborhood is everybody's responsibility.
That's right.
And I do understand that nowadays we do got to be careful because some kids are not trying to hear it, but it still remains the fact that our children is everybody's responsibility. And lastly, number 8, ants teach us that knowledge should be shared.
That's right.
Basically, what ants do is ants leave a chemical trail that allow their colleagues to trace their path to success, which is food.
Mm-hmm.
All right. It would be pointless if they didn't, because although a single ant is capable of carrying up to 50 times its body weight, and that's for real, not much can be carried back to the base for the development of the colony. You know, and we live in a generation where so much envy, so much jealousy, so much crab in the barrel clinging. We don't want to pass on information to people because we are so afraid that if they get the information, they might make out better than we are.
Right.
You know, they're better than we do.
Right.
And when you are solidified in who you are, solidified in knowing that you have gifts, talents, and abilities, solidified in knowing that you have worth and value that you bring to the world, unlike any other, because there's only one of you in the world, you can share information. And if they get it, they get it. And you can be happy for them because you understand that what God has for you is for you.
That's right.
That's it. That's all I got.
Nice.
That's it.
All right.
Let's put it out there.
Put it out there.
All right. I'm Actor Kevin D. Benton. You can follow me on Twitter at Kevin D. Benton. And follow me on Facebook, Actor Kevin D. Benton. And I will follow back.
All right. You can find me, Actress Nikee Wan, on Facebook. That's Nikee Wan. On Twitter, at Nikee Wan. And on Instagram, it's Hello, I'm Nikee. That's spelled HelloIm Nikee. NikeeE. And follow us on the group, The Kevin and Nikee Show, on Kevin and Nikee Show on Facebook.
Facebook.
And The Kevin Nikee Show on Twitter. Nice. Yeah. And if you have any questions, comments, concerns regarding the show,
like Miss Pat,
yes, hit us up, The Kevin and Nikee Show at yahoo.com. Yahoo.
And we will talk about it.
We sure will. You have any questions, comments, concerns for Atif Lanier, email us. We'll read it to him, get the answer, and we'll tell it to you on the show.
That's right. Guess
what? We will do that.
We sure will.
Talk to us. As you can see, we will talk back because we love to
talk. We love to talk.
Yes. And do not forget, we have YouTube channel.
Yeah, check us out on YouTube.
We Actor. Got the bridge up there. Actor Kevin D. Benton. Yeah. And Actress Nikee Wan.
Check us out on YouTube. We got movies up there. Short films, feature films. We got video clips. You know, check us out. You know.
Yes, and just to let you know, a few announcements. PIFA, Philadelphia International Film Awards are coming up in May.
Okay, that's what's up.
Yes, get your tickets.
Get your ticket.
Get your tickets. And also, we have another premiere of
The Decade.
The Decade coming up.
Shout out to Delia
Delancer. Coming up this month on the 31st. So we definitely want to invite you out to that because we're in it and
we played like about 10 different zombies.
Oh my goodness, we did.
Yeah, we had so much we had so many wardrobe options. I mean, we would die as one zombie and come back as another. Just change our clothes. But the good thing is the way they did the color scheme and the editing, you won't be able to tell.
Never know.
It's dope.
Yeah, so
it's a good movie. It's a great movie. Sure is. So where can they get the tickets? They go on Facebook.
They can go on Facebook. The Decade has a Facebook page. Yeah, they go on there.
The Decade.
Yes.
Yes. Go on Facebook. Get your tickets. It's going to be nice.
Yeah, and for PIFA, Philadelphia International Film Awards, you can go on that website as well.
Right.
Okay, and get your tickets for that.
Yeah, I went about 2-3 years ago. It was phenomenal.
Nice.
It was very, very encouraging, inspirational. Mm-hmm. I went out just to support my friends.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they got awards. Nikee Diller got an award.
Nice.
Brian A. Wilson was hosting. It was nice. Just, it was great. And it made me just want to go home and say, I need to get on my line because you know what?
Nice.
I would like the opportunity to be up there and get an award and things. And so it was very, very inspirational.
And shout out to all of the nominees this year. Awesome sauce. Congratulations on your success.
That's right. Continued success to you.
Yeah.
All right.
It's the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio.
We out.
We are everywhere.
And we everywhere and we out.
That's right.
That's it.
Boom.
Oh, baby. Thinking about the way you smile.
Keep thinking about the way you laugh. Yeah.
Oh. Takes me away. Takes me away. Yeah.
Oh.
There were times when I wasn't sure that we were gonna last beyond the sun. But after years, it's clear we were meant to be. But something's been lost along the way. Remember times we just laughed for no reason at all. And all those feelings of anticipation. We've grown accustomed to life without living at all. But something went wrong along the way.
Oh, baby, oh, baby. Maybe I need to feel that sunshine. That light that used to glow up on my face. Oh, baby, maybe we need to find that sunshine. The way that I'm shining on yesterday.
No, I'm not questioning love's devotion.
That's true, baby.
But there's an emptiness here in my heart that
can only be filled by you.
So, baby, let's take the time to find our way. We can't just sit back as we fall victim to life's mundane.
Sleep, but I've heard the wake-up call, baby.
Before we get lost along the way.
Yesterday.
into hours. Hours turned into days. Days turned into years, and years turned into ever. And our shine, our beautiful shine.
You have been listening to the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio. Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
2,500 feet! Time to pull our chutes!
25? Did you hear you could save up to 25% off grocery store prices at BJ's Wholesale Club?
Did you say save up to 25% at BJ's?
Yeah, save up to 25% at BJ's!
Whoa! That's like saving up to 1/4 of... That's gonna leave a mark.
BJ's. Absurdly simple savings. Shop today. Not a member? Go to BJ's.com/simple savings.
Lucky Land Slots. Asking people, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
Lucky? In line at the deli, I guess?
Aha, in my dentist's office. More than once, actually.
Do I have to say?
Yes, you do.
In the car before my kids' PTA meeting.
Really?
Yes.
Excuse me, what's the weirdest place you've gotten lucky?
I never win and tell.
Well, there you have it. You can get lucky anywhere, playing at LuckyLandSlots.com. Play for free right now. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18+. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.